I don't know how many of you saw the TV series The House of Cards on Netflix. Of course, you all don't have Netflix necessarily, but that series became very popular, and it was being talked about broader media beyond Netflix. And this particular series is a political drama that shows the intrigues in Washington, D.C. And Frank and Claire Underwood are a power couple in Washington. When the series opened, Frank is the House Majority Leader, House Majority Whip. And eventually in the series, he's actually elected President of the United States. But one of the most intriguing elements of the show to me is the difference between the image presented to the public and the behind-the-scenes political machinations that go on, right? What's presented to the public and what's really going on behind the scenes. In fact, one of the sort of different things about the series is from time to time, Frank Underwood will look directly in the camera to direct it to us, the audience, right? And he will let us know with some kind of a sly comment to reveal what he's really thinking instead of what he's just said or just done in the public sphere. So we find that the public image is really an image. It's not the substance. It's a sales promotion. But the substance of the political product is so very different than what the poster is on the outside. The Pew Charitable Trust conducted a study in 2016 called the Religious Landscape Study. And they discovered that the fastest growing religious affiliation are the non-affiliated, the nuns they call them. They're not affiliated with any religious group, the churches being the main one of that. And these are people who they believe in God, they consider themselves spiritual, but they just don't want to affiliate with the church or with any religious organization. And they also did follow-up in asking, okay, well, why do you not want to associate formally with a church or a religious group? And one of the main reasons, not the only reason, but one of the primary reasons was because of hypocrisy. Hypocrisy. Too many Christians are doing too many unchristian things. Is this making sense to anybody? According to the non-religious and to the nuns or the non-affiliated, church people are just as two-faced as Frank and Claire Underwood in our political scene. And curiously enough, this is precisely the charge that Jesus levels against the religious leaders of his day, the Pharisees, the scribes, and religious lawyers. Hypocrisy. To use his words, you Pharisees clean the outside of the cup and of the dish, but inside you're full of greed and wickedness. What the non-religious and the non-religiously affiliated in our society want are the very same from us Christians, is the very same thing that Jesus is demanding of the religious leaders of his day. Authenticity. Integrity. What we say and what we do match up. Our inner life and our outer life are aligned and rooted with a deep relationship with God and Jesus Christ. So Jesus, along with the non-religious and non-affiliated in our world, want nothing to do with religious pretentiousness. They don't want image over substance. They don't want to pretend, the pretend version versus the real. Jesus was invited to dinner at a Pharisee's house. And knowing all the customs of his day, he knew perfectly well that the guest list, because of the whole honor system in society, the other guests that he invited would be other religious leaders, more Pharisees and scribes and religious lawyers. And so Jesus knew who was going to be there when he accepted the invitation. And he went to the party with the intention of blowing the place to bits. He went to totally disrupt and destroy that dinner party. You don't want to invite somebody to do this to your dinner party. But Jesus went and did it on purpose. He purposefully refrained from washing his hands before the meal, knowing perfectly well the reaction it would bring from his host and the other guests. Jesus deliberately picked a fight in order to make a deliberate point, a dramatic point, this intentional insult for him was a prophetic move. From time to time, the prophets will do a prophetic action. They will do something that's dramatic, that shocks the people and draws their attention to it, so that they can really bring God's word home and a point to them at this point. So Jesus's intentional insult is a prophetic move. He's acting in a prophetic mode, and he's doing something scandalous, as prophets do from time to time. So Jesus knew the comment he was going to get from his host when he refrained from washing his hands, but he was ready, and he hits them. I'm sure this was like totally out of the blue and surprised them to no end. "You Pharisees clean the outside of the cup and of the dish, but inside you're all full of greed and wickedness. You fools," that was very strong language, "you fools, did not the one who made the outside make the inside also? So give alms for those things that are within, and see, everything will be clean for you." Washing hands before a meal had to do with ritual purity. And all things can make you ritually impure, but the religious, since these guys are religious leaders, they're experts in what's religiously pure and impure, and it was their job to hold religious purity. And they were fastidious religiously, right? But Jesus knows what's on the inside. This did not take any special divine revelation. What Jesus was just, anyone with eyes to see in society that hung around with scribes and Pharisees for a while could know that there was a big difference between what's going on in here and what's going on out there. Jesus knows what's on the inside. He knows that the dishes are filthy on the inside, even if they're spotless and ritually clean on the outside. Jesus says, "You neglect justice and the love of God." He knows that they crave honor in the public square and wanted to be treated as VIPs everywhere that they went. Shamefully, this is far too familiar to us. Too many religious leaders have been caught in a double life. All of us can bring to mind shocking scandals that have sickened us and have severely harmed our Christian brand and image. I don't have to mention a single case because all of you have different cases going around in your minds. We've all know of these cases, and not all of them are the famous ones up in public. I was raised in the church. My dad was a pastor. I can name a lot of situations. The problem is that the outside of the cup may look pristine and even glamorous, while the inside is corrupt and very probably broken. I have a little compassion for these people because I know of the brokenness that is behind the corruption inside. We may miss an important element of Jesus' point unless we understand Jesus' critique of purity, religious purity. The religious purity laws and practices of Jesus' day had the effect, really, of dividing people. They created social and religious barriers between people. It was a form of religiously sanctioned division. You could even call it a form of classism or bigotry. For example, a man would have almost nothing to do with a woman who was not a part of his own family. This is still true in many cultures and parts of the world, shamefully speaking, I think. They wouldn't touch people who were sick, and they had a religious excuse to separate themselves and not practice social solidarity. Last week we talked about the Good Samaritan with the priest and the Levite who walked by on the other side rather than taking care of this man who had been beat up and robbed and whose life was in danger. So these religious purity laws in Jesus' day, and the religious leaders who were the most fastidious about all of this, this had the effect of creating a sense of superiority, a superiority of the ritually pure. They would look down their nose at the ritually unclean and did not feel that they had to love them as their neighbor. They could put them in this category over here: you're ritually unclean, I don't have to treat you as well, I can even ignore you, because I certainly don't want to be contaminated in the process. This reminds me of my dad's experience, some of my dad's experiences. My dad was a Methodist pastor, and I would remember that he would not go into a pool hall. He loved to play pool. And I talked with him about it. He said, I won't go into a pool hall because if one of my church members sees me, they will think less of me and it will hurt my ministry. The same went for bars. My dad didn't drink alcohol at all, but he would not go into a bar for the same reason. He was afraid that it would shake people's confidence in his religious purity. He was mostly worried about his own church folks more than the people that were in the pool hall. They're in the bar, right? Dad could have developed relationships and given ministry to people and maybe even led people to Christ if he had gone to the bar and had a Coca-Cola while the other guy had his beer and shot some pool with folks. A woman friend of mine in Barcelona, a pastor friend of mine, Carmen Sanchez, she's now retired. But she's an amazing evangelist. Not an evangelist who stands in churches behind pulpits and preaches, the kind of evangelist who meets people and helps transform their lives. When they appointed her to one of I think it was the last church where she retired, or near the end, she went to a church in a suburb of Barcelona, one of the highest density population centers of the world, a worker's suburb. And just down the street from the church was a little park where all the druggies hung out. Well, what did she do? She went out and hung out with them, got to know them by name, and she ended up leading a good group of them to Christ, and some of them became leaders in her church, and there are no more druggies in that park today because of Carmen. But it wasn't because she was an evangelist standing here. It was because she was living her life and getting to know them. Well, Carmen told me this incredible story that she had befriended this prostitute on the Ramblas. The Ramblas, if you've been to Barcelona, you know what it is. If you haven't, it's the most gorgeous promenade that goes through the city down to the port. And it's just an exquisite, wonderful experience to go on the Ramblas. Well, Carmen had gotten to know this prostitute on the Ramblas pretty well, to the point that the prostitute trusted her enough to let her hold her money for her. And that's something. And would take her up to her apartment. Well, Carmen was slated to speak about, to promote some ministry in this local church. And this lady from the church she was going to speak at on Sunday saw her on the Ramblas with this prostitute. And she saw that she went up to the prostitute's apartment. So she spread the word that Carmen was not a trustworthy minister of the gospel because she hung around with prostitutes and even went up to their apartment. What in the world must they be doing? Carmen had violated this woman's religious purity laws, right? But Carmen was doing precisely what Jesus wanted. Carmen's a person of integrity. Her heart is full of God's love for people. Her words and her deeds match up. She's authentic and not at all pretentious. Carmen is an example of what the non-religious and the non-affiliated in our country are screaming for. Authenticity, integrity, what we say and what we do matches up. Our inner life and our outer life are aligned and rooted in a living relationship with God in Christ. Please don't get the impression that I'm speaking against religious life and ritual. Not at all. And Jesus isn't either. Just listen to what he says. You tithe mint and rue and herbs of all kinds and neglect justice and the love of God. It is these, that is justice and love of God, you ought to have practiced without neglecting the others, the tithing part. Jesus is not criticizing tithing. He has no problem with washing your hands before meals. He did that all on his own most of the time anyway. But Jesus wants the substance to match the image. He wants the purity of heart to be at the center of the deed. You and I can be the real deal, authentic persons with integrity. I believe most, if not all of us here, are. We can have an authentic relationship with God and be faithful to the gospel. And it requires a couple of things of us. I'm just going to mention a couple in passing. One of the first things living authentically and with integrity requires is self-honesty. We have to be brutally honest with ourselves and be open for correction from others. We have to be honest. I don't think these Pharisees were very open to Jesus correcting them. And they probably felt very threatened by the kind of honesty Jesus was calling for. But if we can, for us to be persons of integrity and authentic in our faith, we have to be honest with ourselves. There can be no room for pretentiousness, and substance has to matter so much more than image. Secondly, we live our lives with integrity when we're rooted in a deep, living relationship with God. Our primary commitment in our lives is to be aligned with God as the primary reference point for our lives. The world no longer sets the standards for us, so that when we are faced with a decision, do I follow what I know is God's way, or do I follow the world's way, or what my personal ego wants to do, when there is a conflict between those, what decision am I going to make? Integrity is when we know ahead of time what our choice is going to make. And what Jesus is calling for, and what the non-religious and the non-affiliated are calling for, is that they will know the choice we will make ahead of time. When they see us face with the difference between our values that come from our rootedness in God and of the values of the world, whether in conflict or of our own personal egos, they know how we're going to choose. They know we're going to line up with God, even at the expense of our personal ego or the adulation of the crowd. Authenticity and integrity are rooted in honesty and in alignment with God. To use Jesus' language, don't focus on the outside of the cup, but on the inside. They both need to match. But Jesus says, give for alms those things that are within, and see, everything will be clean for you. He's implying that when you take care of the inside, it will show on the outside. My friend Carmen can associate with druggies and prostitutes without being dragged down, without being compromised, because she's authentic. She's not threatened with contamination or religious impurity. To the contrary, she contaminates others. And when Carmen spends time with these unclean people, they often end up following Jesus Christ. Let us be contagiously authentic. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, your words are hard, but boy, are they needed to us today. Us as individuals, we as a church, we as a country, we as a world need your truth. We need to be called to honesty, to correction. We need to be called to rootedness in life with you, in connection with you. And we need your help. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you live within us by the Holy Spirit, that your presence is in us, and we are able to be honest, we are able to be persons who are authentic and have integrity, so that our insides are clean as well as our outsides, so that what we are on the inside is reflected also on the outside. Oh God, help us to be like Carmen, that our authenticity would actually be contagious to other people. And so those people that others may wonder about us being contaminated with, rather these people would be contaminated with our love for God and Jesus Christ. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. It's not easy to hear a difficult word, but let me tell you, when you follow and respond from the heart to a difficult word of Jesus, it changes you, it cleans you, it frees you, and it sets you on the right path, doesn't it? We're about to worship with our offering, and I insist on having a prayer for our offering because it's an act of worship. Physically, I'll ask you to put your offering in the box as you walk out today, along with your Connect cards, but this is a part of our act of worship to God. Let us pray and offer ourselves to God. Oh God, we want to thank you for all you give to us. Thank you for the word you receive. Thank you for the music and the prayers. Thank you for the presence you've had in our lives this week. And God, as we give to you in this offering space. We also pray that you would use it to make your vision become a reality. In Christ's name, amen.